These carefully targeted actions are designed to disrupt the use of Afghanistan as a terrorist base of operations.
And in Afghanistan, we're increasing our troops.
Military power alone will not bring peace to Afghanistan or stop the terrorist threat.
It's about ending an era of major military operations to remake other countries.
We're pursuing long-term victory in this war by promoting democracy in the Middle East so that the nations of that region no longer breed hatred and terror.
It remained America's view after the Cold War, particularly if there were going to be countries that were not Western democracies that were going to be breeding grounds for terrorism. After 9/11, George W. Bush moved into that camp.
But we've also got an ideology based upon liberty, which stands in stark contrast to the ideology of the thugs and murderers called the Taliban.
The danger with the Bush administration's foreign policy and their characterization of the threat as regime-based is that it lends itself to overreach. All of a sudden, you have an axis of evil in North Korea and Syria and Iraq and Iran, and that distracts from the central mission in Afghanistan.
American and coalition forces are in the early stages of military operations to disarm Iraq, to free its people.
Presidents very rarely, after their presidencies, say, "I made lots of mistakes." He still supports his decisions to invade Afghanistan and Iraq.
Our goal is to destroy Al-Qaeda, and we are on a path to do exactly that.
I think Barack Obama's was much more realistic, and it was much more accurate about the capacity for the United States.
Afghans are responsible for the security of their nation, and we build an equal partnership between two sovereign states, a future in which war ends and a new chapter begins.
Afghanistan is far more peripheral as a national security issue, particularly after the death of Osama bin Laden.
The United States has conducted an operation that killed Osama bin Laden, the leader of Al-Qaeda.
The mistake was in the surge decision. The theory of counterinsurgency and how we were going to win the war changed.
We are a partner and a friend, but we will not dictate to the Afghan people how to live or how to govern their own complex society.
Because he had virtually no political experience except for running for president, I don't think that he had a vision for Afghanistan. The view of Donald Trump was to eliminate American forces, and indeed he started so-called peace talks with the Taliban.
There hasn't been a moment like this. We've had very successful negotiations. We think they'll be successful in the end.
And I think the Trump administration and those negotiating that deal felt a lot of that same pressure, that they wanted to get a deal before they left office. The human rights element, which had been so central to U.S. foreign policy, was not important to those in power.
We are not nation building again. We are killing terrorists.
I made the decision. The buck stops with me.
Biden is interesting because he's very much shaped by personal experience.
I carry that burden every day, just as I did when I was vice president. My son was deployed to Iraq for a year.
And the view was that we were not really going to be able to create a democratic republic in a culture, in a society with ancient tribal and religious differences.
I cannot and will not ask our troops to fight on endlessly in another country's civil war.
The Biden administration was trying to adhere to a deadline that it inherited and that it didn't want to change.
The idea that somehow there's a way to have gotten out without chaos ensuing, I don't know how that happens.
I would hope that it would have shaped all four of the presidents the way Vietnam tended to shape presidents. If I look across the four presidencies, I would sum it up succinctly by saying it was a success followed by a failure.